We're live now, Modi. Modi?
Should we begin?
Yeah.
Obid,
are you giving me the go ahead, sir, with your kind permission? All right.
Yeah. You may start now.
A very good afternoon to everybody present here and a hearty welcome on behalf of the Department of Education, Dirozio Memorial College, and the entire college that is Dirozio Memorial College. We all the members of this college, we welcome you heartily. This is Mohua from the Department of English, Dirozio Memorial College. Today we have assembled here, though virtually, we have assembled here for the two-day international webinar on online education in new normal, coping with mental hazards, which has been organized by the Department of Education in collaboration with Internal Quality Assurance Cell, that is ICAP, of Dirozio Memorial College. And we are overwhelmed by the kind of stupendous response that we have received from all of you, dear participants. The number precisely is 1058. That is the number of registered participants, and that is phenomenal. I mean, 1,058 participants for a particular webinar. That response, it's so heartening and it has humbled us so much. And we genuinely believe that the kind of trust, the kind of conviction that you have shown towards us, we sincerely hope that we would be able to live up to your expectations. So with that note, we would begin our webinar today. I would welcome our principal, sir, Dr. Dibendu Tolapatro, who has already arrived here. And we have our revered resource persons, whom sir would introduce you with, all of you. So the resource persons are here. The resource person for the first technical session, Dr. Shoirindri Sen, from Gopalchandra Memorial College of Education. She is here. We have the resource person for the next day, Prem sir, who is here also, who has been kind enough to be here for day one as well. So we are all here, and we have amongst us the organizers of this seminar, Debashish Chattopadhyay and Subarna Ghosh Ramanto, who are from the Department of Education. So we have assembled here for the inaugural session. But before we begin with the inaugural session, let me tell you that right now we would be starting the welcome address, which would be delivered by our principal, sir. But after that, the inaugural address that was scheduled as per the brochure, that has been postponed a bit because our vice chancellor, sir, because of his prior commitments, he could make it right now, but he would definitely be here now after some time, maybe around 3:45 or so. So what we have planned to do it is like that. Firstly, we will have the welcome address, and then we would go to the first technical session straight away, and then we would again come back for the inaugural address, which when our honorable vice chancellor sir joins. So that is the way we have planned it. Let us begin with the inaugural session. And I would request Dr. Dibendu Tolapatro, Principal, Dirozio Memorial College, to deliver the welcome address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mohua. A very good afternoon to all of you. I welcome all the participants who have joined the webinar, Online Education in New Normal, Coping with the Mental Hazards, organized by the Department of Education in collaboration with the Internal Quality Assurance Cell, IQAC, of Dirozio Memorial College. We are extremely delighted to have with us Professor Bashop Chowdhury, Honorable Vice Chancellor, West Bengal State University, as guest of honor for this inaugural session. He has always been our pillar of strength and has encouraged us in all academic endeavors. His presence today will not only uplift the morale of the teachers of the Department of Education, but also serve as immense inspiration for all the students and teachers participating in this program. Our Honorable Vice Chancellor is at present busy with some other program, and he will join us after the first lecture. We heartily welcome you, sir. I express my sincere gratitude to Dr. Abhijit Kumar Pal, Professor and Head Department of Education, West Bengal State University, for accepting the offer to deliver the keynote address. But as he is seriously ill, he could not join us. We pray God for his early recovery. I also welcome the honorable speakers of day one, Dr. Shoirindri Sen, Assistant Professor, Gopalchandra Memorial College of Education, WBU TTEPA, Kolkata, Dr. Amulya Kumar Acharya, associate professor and head department of education, Fakir Mohan University, Balasore, Odisha; Dr. Prem J. H. Hiralal, professor, department of psychology of education, University of South Africa; Dr. Shantam Mishra, former principal, Kishatya Sai College for Women, Utkal University; visiting professor, International Institute of Rehabilitation Science and Research, Bhubaneswar, Odisha; and Dr. Nandita Deb, professor, assistant professor and head department of education, Shishuram Das College, Calcutta University, Kolkata. I welcome you all from the bottom of my heart. Since the COVID-19 pandemic has disrupted the normal lifestyle of people across the globe, students are in trauma as how to cope up with the situation. The virtual world has come to the rescue. The colleges and universities have shifted their base to virtual platform to conduct classes online. Consequently, catering to the needs of all stages of education from college to university level, online education has emerged as an alternative to ordinary face-to-face classes. Many online platforms have also come up. Today, we are switching to a new platform, the StreamYard platform. My sincere thanks to Dr. Obhik Roy, librarian of Derozio Memorial College, and Sri Aditya Banerjee for providing technical support to conduct this seminar. I am also thankful to the teachers and of education department for selecting such an useful topic. I express my sincere thanks to the IQVC coordinator, Dr. Choitali Mukherjee, Dr. Shoikat Mondol, Dr. Anjana Chatterjee, conveners of seminar committee, Dr. Mohua Bhomik doing the moderation work, and to other teachers and students and all the participants who have joined hands to make this program a successful one. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. You have always been our source of inspiration, guiding us, you know, giving us all valuable advices at every step that we take. So thank you for being with us, sir. Your presence really makes all our academic programs so meaningful. Thank you very much. Okay, so we would move away straight to the technical session, because as sir told you earlier that the keynote address was supposed to be delivered by Dr. Abhijit Kumar Pal, professor and head department of education, West Bengal State University. But with a very heavy heart, we are bound to announce here that he is terribly, terribly sick, and his family members are also very critically ill. So we should all pray for his and his family members' speedy recovery. And he couldn't make it today, unfortunately. And so we regret the kind of inconvenience that has been caused because of that. But you know, that is you all understand that is not in our hands, and it's not at all deliberate. So I'm sure that you are going to forgive us for that. And so we would move away to the technical session, the first technical session today. I'm both delighted and honored to have amongst us Dr. Shoirindri Sen, who is Assistant Professor, Gopal Chandra Memorial College of Education, Kolkata. I'm sure that she would be, you know, giving us a very inspiring and motivating kind of a lecture, because since this is the kind of scenario that we are in now, this the COVID-19 pandemic situation that is prevalent all around the globe. So there to be optimistic, to retain a positive mental health, that is so very essential. So I must congratulate the Department of Education also that they have chosen such a pertinent topic, which is so relevant in today's world. So I'm sure that this lecture by Dr. Shoirindri Sen would be very, very important and very useful for us. I would love to give you a brief bio note of Dr. Sen. Dr. Sen completed her master's in English from Calcutta University. She did her B.Ed. and M.Ed. from Calcutta University, and she is a proud recipient of the gold medal in M.Ed. She had completed her doctoral thesis in education from Calcutta University. She has a work experience of quite some time, and that is 18 years. She is presently working as assistant professor in English in Gopal Chandra Memorial College of Education. She had earlier worked as principal in Kamala Devi Sohan Raj Singh Vijayan College of Education. She worked as a full-time assistant professor in English in Shyama Prasad Institute of Education and Training. She had also worked as a part-time lecturer in Vidyasagar College of Women for Women, Shyama Prasad College and Shyama Prasad Institute of Technology and Management. She worked as guest faculty in Jadavpur Vidyapeeth College of Education, and she worked as an academic counselor for IGNU. We would all love to listen to you, ma'am. And the topic that she has chosen today for her deliberation is digital tools for online teaching. Over to you, ma'am, Dr. Shoirindri Sen.
Thank you, madam. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure for me to be a part of this webinar. And I'm here to deliver a discourse on a topic which is very pertinent today. Though I feel that your topic is it's more based on mental hazards, but my topic of selection that I've selected is digital tools. So now it's a very vast topic. So I it's just not possible to complete all the digital tools within this span of time. So I've just chosen a very pertinent digital tool which is going to be very helpful not only to the working teachers but also for people who are running tutorials and students who are teaching other students. So I've just chosen Google Classroom, and I'm going to give you an extensive presentation on the same. So with due permission, I would like to share my screen now. I have a PowerPoint presentation. Is it visible to all of you? Kindly respond if it's visible or not.
Yes,
it's visible. Thank you. Thank you so much. So without wasting much time, I would like to go straight. Right. Now, this basically has to do with, like, the first slide tells about the changing face of education. That is, now education has had a vast change in the recent past. We have moved from traditional classroom to Google Classroom and digital learning. And we have moved from face-to-face education, reading books, to education which is based on e-learning and, of course, now mobile learning. So now education has become as accessible as possible to all of us. Now, I would rather insist that though your webinar topic is based on mental hazards, I would request all of you to take things on a positive note. And of course, overindulgence of anything is bad, whether it's technology or otherwise. So if you can just balance your the measures that you take, I would always prefer you to take a positive thinking attitude and carry on with the digital learning trend. Now, this is the scenario presently, that is how we have traveled from the face-to-face mode of classroom to a digital classroom. And whether it is COVID or not, it is important for us to note that the blended learning pattern has come into the trend. And we all have to abide by it. We all have to cope up with it. And we have to understand that it's a very enriching experience to have both face-to-face online and offline mode of education. So now I come to my, with a background note, I come to my present day's presentation on digital tools for online teaching. And my topic for today is Google Classroom. Now, this basically is a video which I'm going to show. At the very onset, I'm going to show you how you are going to create a Google Classroom. So please follow as I explain to you. First, you have to go to the Google browser. You have to be logged into your Gmail ID. Remember to do that. You have to click on the apps. Just scroll down. Yes. You have this icon of Google Classroom. Just click on that. That is one way of accessing. The other way of accessing is just type classroom.google.com on your Google browser, and it's going to open, and you can get an access to your Google Classroom. So now I'm going to click on this Google Classroom. This is an easier access process. So I'm just opening the Google Classroom. These are the classrooms that I have already created. This is the basic interface of Google Classroom. if you can see, right? So at first, this plus sign leads you to two options. One is to create a class, and the one is to and the other is to join the class. Joining the class is done by your students, and creating is of course done by the teacher. All right. So you have to create a class on this Google platform, which I'm going to show you how you're going to do. So this creating option will give you this using Classroom at School with students, whether it's a G Suite account or not. You have to give a declaration that this is a personal account, because G Suite accounts are entitled to separate payment and privacy policies and all. So you just read through this and just make an undertaking. Just click on the checkbox and say that this is a personal account, and just click on continue. Right, just click on continue. Now you are supposed to give a name. Now just pay attention here. There is one required thing written over here. Required means mandatory. Wherever you find it required online, that is, it's mandatory. So what you have to do is you have to give a name to your classroom, Google Classroom. And you can give any name for that matter, BA, BSc, BCom, first year, second year, third year, whatever. So for a demonstration purpose, I have chosen to give this name as, say, maybe B.Ed. Second Semester English Pedagogy. So this is going to be the name of my classroom. B.Ed. Second Semester English Pedagogy. Right? I give a section, anything for that matter. I'm just giving, for demonstration purpose, I'm just writing a section. Subject, you have to write a subject. For me, it's English. So please pardon me, because my subject is English. So often I'll be giving you examples from the subject. So please pardon that. And just click on create. Room is not mandatory. If you want, you can add room number. So now your classroom is being created. Right. So now this is your second semester English pedagogy classroom. This is basically the interface of your classroom. This is your exclusive classroom code. When you click on this box, you get this classroom code. Every classroom will have its separate code, and you have to share this with your students. Just copy paste it and share it with your students on social media so that they can join it through classroom.google.com by typing this classroom code. This is one way by which your students can join the class. Now, this is basically the theme of your class, right? Which you can, of course, change. There are two options. Either you can select a theme from whatever is given, or you can upload a theme from your system, which you must have saved. I mean, if you save a picture, relevant picture in your system, you can just upload it. Now, let me select a picture which is given. Some gallery of pictures are given according to subject matter. So just see English and history, maths and science, arts, sports, everything. You've got a variety of pictures given for your theme. So at random, I'm just selecting any one of them for demonstration purpose. So let me select this one. Right. So I click on select class theme. So now my theme is going to change. Now look, my theme has changed. So this is basically the look of my, the basic look of my theme and my classroom. Like, this is my basic look of my Google Classroom. So now I move on to the next step. Now, here we are going to get started with the Google Classroom. We are going to know what exactly is there inside the Google Classroom. Right. Now, Google Classroom basically has got four important tabs which you have to learn and which you have to know. This is another classroom which I have created. So I'm demonstrating with this one, and this is the interface of another one. So you have four tabs. This is stream, this is classwork, right? This is people, and this is grades, right? These are basically the four tabs or in any Google Classroom, right? Let's come to the stream page. Okay. Now, the stream page basically is like the Facebook page, where you get the notifications of every activity you do on Google Classroom. If you share an assignment, if you share a material, if your students communicate with you, if you communicate with your students, everything gets reported, right? So for example, here it's written share something with your class. For example, I want to share something with my class. I can click on this. So I can share some information. I can add a file also as an attachment to this directly from here. And I can select whichever class I want to share my information with. So and I can even select the students I want to share with. I may not share with the entire class. So now if I, for example, I want to just share an information with my students that tomorrow the class will be scheduled at 11 a.m. All right. So the online class, I mean, which I take for my regular students. So tomorrow the class will be held at 11 a.m. Okay. So now what I do is I click on post. When I click on post, all my students get this notification on email that I have sent a notice that tomorrow's class will be at 11 a.m. All right, so this is how you communicate with your students. Now, this part is for the upcoming section. That is, in case you have to announce anything which is coming up, you can put it up on this one. Okay. So this is the upcoming section. Right. So this is the classroom code that you have. See, this class will have a different classroom code. It's written over here. See, copy invite link. So I can copy this link and I can share it with my students and invite them to join my class. Okay. So this is basically the stream page, right? Now we move on to the classwork page. The classwork page is most important because this is here where you share your materials, your assignments, say all the topics I've created and the materials I've shared with my students, they are recorded over here. Okay. So this is a very important page. So what you do is just click on create and these options come: assignment, quiz assignment, question, material, reusing a previous post, creating a topic. So you can create all these things from this page. Okay. So this is a very rich one, and this is a class drive folder which automatically saves whatever you share in your Google Drive, and this is the Google Calendar where you can schedule all your reminders for any important assignments. So this so nothing gets lost from here, everything gets saved. Now this is a People's tab. Here my name appears as a default because I have opened the class. So right, if I want, I can add co-teachers. Now these are my regular students with whom I interact on Google Classroom. Now I want to add, for example, if I want to add a co-teacher to my Google Classroom, what I can do is I can type, for example, the name of a co-teacher. For demonstration purpose, I've just selected any random name. And I can just send an invitation via mail to this individual and I click on invite. So this person can join my class and do all the activities in my class along with me. This name is not appearing prominently because he's not yet accepted the invitation. As soon as he accepts it, this will appear prominently. Right. Now we come to the students page, students section. I can add students in another way. I can copy and paste this link and send it through WhatsApp or other social media to my students, or else I can type the name and email ID of any student over here, and I can send an invitation through mail. Just click on invite. So your student gets an invitation through mail. See, the other students who have joined, they're appearing more prominently. This name appears on a lighter shade. This is basically because this person has not yet joined. As soon as this person joins, his name will also appear prominently. Okay, so these are my this is how you add a student into your class. Now, if I want to communicate individually with a student, I can just click on this and email the particular student. I can click on the checkbox and I can email the particular student. And if I want to communicate like with the entire class, then what I do is I just click on this checkbox and all my students get selected. The actions being email, remove or mute. So I can communicate or do whatever I want with all the students also at a time. Right. So this is how we are communicating with the students on Google Classroom. this name, for example, if I want to remove a student, so I just click on the checkbox beside the student and I just click remove. So now I can click remove again and I can remove the student from my class. All right. So this is basically the people's tab and people's tab on Google Classroom. Now we come to the grade tab. Here you have all the marks of your the assignments and quizzes that you give. You get a class average as well as individual marks. So you can get a bird's eye view. See, one assignment I have marked and the other one is not yet marked. So this gives you the view of the progress of the students. So now we come back to the stream page. Just recapitulate this. We have four tabs: stream, classwork, people, and grades. So that is the entire whatever is constitutes your Google Classroom. Now a very crucial part: adding material to the Google Classroom. Now all our students are very keen upon getting study materials. So they all tell us, madam, where to refer to, what book to refer to. And, you know, like this Google Classroom gives you an opportunity to share different types of materials from various sources, both as PDF versions or video versions or audio versions or whatever it is. And it gives the students an enriching experience altogether. So let us see how we are going to add material to the Google Classroom. Now, for adding any material to the Google Classroom, you just open your Google Classroom and you just go to classwork page. Right. So these are the materials, as I showed you earlier, that I have already shared with my class. So you just click on create. And you click on topic first, because you divide your assignments into different topics first. When we go to the class, we divide our allotment into topics. So let me just select this topic, pedagogical analysis. So this is my basic topic. Now I have created this topic. My students will not be able to see the topic unless I add material to this. So now I click on create material. I can add material from different sources. For example, Google Drive, from link, from file, and from YouTube. So let me click on Google Drive. I have saved a PDF file in my Google Drive. So I just click on this and I click on insert. So now this file gets uploaded to my Google Classroom. So now what I have to do is I have to give it a title. For example, Introduction to Pedagogical Analysis. This is a part of my BEd curriculum, so I've given this name, this Pedagogical Analysis. And I just give a description. When your students receive the mail, this is what they're going to read, your description, that what material you have shared, right? So this material will give you an introduction to pedagogical analysis. So I write a description. You can just write any description for that matter. I have just written something for demonstration purpose. So now I select which batch of students I want to share it with. I can share with the entire class, or I can just select a few students also. I may not share with everyone. I click on topic and I just click on, these are all the topics that I have created. All right, all the topics that I have created. So I just click on pedagogical analysis, the topic which I created. So now this material will get auto-saved under this topic in my classwork page, right? And in my Google Drive also, see, it's getting saved. Now, posting has these options. I can post right away. I can schedule the material for the future. I can save a draft or I can discard the draft. Right. So now, when I post it, I just click on post. So my students get to see the material right away. So my material appears on my classwork page. See, it's appearing under the topic, well arranged. It's appearing on the stream page that I have shared a material, Introduction to Pedagogical Analysis, right? So at a go, my students will be able to see that I've shared a material. Now the next source from where you can add a material is, you click on create material. this time let me click on file. Now if you have saved any file in your system, that is in your personal computer, you can upload the same. You just click on upload, browse, right? You click on I have saved the material on my desktop, so I can access it from my desktop. I select it and open it. Now it gets uploaded to my class, right? So I add one more material. I have selected one more file, which is again there on my desktop. So I select it once again. I browse and I just select the relevant material. Yes. And I open it. This too gets selected. This too gets uploaded to my classroom. So now I have to give a title, meaning and components of pedagogical analysis. Meaning and components of pedagogical analysis. I give a description. These materials will explain the meaning and components of pedagogical analysis. I'm just writing a very brief description for the sake of demonstration. Right? So now I click on topic and I select the relevant topic under which this material must be posted, that is pedagogical analysis. And I this time schedule the material. Now I click on schedule. I select a date in future. Of course, remember this, the scheduled date has to be in future. So I just select a date in future on which I want my students to see this material. I select a suitable time, right? And I click on schedule. Now, when I click on schedule, just see, this is my classwork page. And this material, this appears in lighter shade. That means my students can't see this material. Only I can see. And it is not visible on the stream page either. It's only visible on the classwork page. It will be visible only on the schedule date and time. Now, the next source of adding material is link. If I want to share a link. See here, this gives add link. So now what I can do is I can browse the net. For example, this is a suitable material I have found, which I want to share with my students, right? So what I do is I I copy this link and I just paste it over here. Simple. And I add link, right? So now this link gets added to my classroom. I give a title, content and pedagogical analysis. I give a description. Since this is a PPT presentation, I'm mentioning that this is a PPT on pedagogical analysis. Right? Simple. Now I add a topic. Don't forget to add the topic. Okay, so pick on pedagogical analysis. Everything done. It's saving. Now post it. See, it appears on your classwork page. Right? It also appears on your stream page. But my scheduled material is not visible. Remember that. Okay. Now the next source for adding material, create material. This time, let's select YouTube, a very popular source. You have two options. Either you can video search or you can select a URL. So I just click on URL. What I do is I browse the YouTube. For example, I find this video suitable. So all I need to do is I just click on this and I select this video. I just select the URL. I copy it, I paste the URL, right? See, now the video appears, okay? So I just click on add. So my this YouTube video gets added to my classroom, so my students can get access to it. So now I give a title over here, Concept and Stages of Pedagogical Analysis. Whatever you write over here will be received through mail by your students. All right, so it's important. So this video, in description I'm writing, this video will explain the concept and stages of pedagogical analysis. Right? So this is done. I select the topic once again. Right? I click now on post. Right? So my YouTube video gets posted. See, on the classwork page, it's recorded. On the stream page also, it's recorded. Right? So now the next source of adding material, classwork, create, material, add, YouTube. This time, let's do a video search. Now, I can type the suitable topic I want to search. For example, pedagogy of teaching English. I can write whatever topic I may select. Once again, I apologize because examples from my subject area come more spontaneously to me. So I just click on the search button. Now these videos, YouTube videos appear. I can select any one from them. For example, I like the first one. So I just click on that and I click on add. So this video gets added to my classroom. All right. So now I add a title. Pedagogy of Teaching English. Right. I add a description. This video is based on the pedagogy of teaching English. Simple, right? So now I add a topic again, pedagogical analysis. Everything done, just check whether all the things are filled, just post. See, it appears on the classwork page that I have posted a material. It also appears on the stream page that I have posted a material. Right. Now, what I can do is I can even drag and drop materials according to the way I want to arrange and I want my students to see. Topics and materials can be dragged and dropped and rearranged. Right. It's very convenient. See, I can just click on this and see the material also here on the classwork page. Now, let me add material. Show you how to add material from some other sources, though I'll not get into the details of it due to paucity of time. Just click on classwork and create material. Create. Here, you can create a material with the help of Google Docs, slides, sheets, drawings, or forms, right? But these are different lessons altogether, and there is no time, so much of time is not there to demonstrate the whole thing. So I move on to the next segment. Adding assignments to Google Classroom. So you've seen that how much enriching experience you can give to your students by adding materials from different sources to the classroom, and they can, you know, it's not just a class where you just face-to-face you teach. Just imagine if you blend this Google Classroom approach with your regular online online mode of classroom, which you take on maybe, Google Meet or whichever platform. Such a wonderful experience you can give to your students. Now, I have chosen this topic, adding assignments to Google Classroom, because in college level, mostly you give your students assignments. You can even have, you can give quiz to your students, but preparing a quiz is again an engaging matter, so it will take a lot of time. So I'm just showing you assignments. Now, before I start, let me tell you, here I'm going to show you how you are going to create an assignment and share it with your students, how your students are going to see the assignment and answer you back, because many of times our students ask us, ma'am, how we are going to answer you. And after you receive your response from the students, how you are again going to assess and evaluate their assignments and return them back, right? So this is all the whole thing I'm going to tell you. So for that, you have to go to your classwork page and you have to click on create, click on assignment. The same thing, title, instructions you have to give. You can add assignments also from Google Drive, from link, from file, or from YouTube. Right? Or you can create assignments using Google Docs, slides, sheets, drawings, or forms. Right? So let me add one file. I have already prepared an assignment simply with a Word document, and I am going to upload it. Just click on upload, browse. It's saved on my desktop. So I just browse. This is the assignment I have saved, assignment on educational objectives. So I just open it and it gets uploaded. See, the assignment gets uploaded to my Google Classroom. Now what I do is I give it a title. For example, I write assignment on educational objectives. I give it marks. Say, for example, I give 10 marks. I give a due date and time. That is the deadline by which they need to submit the assignment, the date and the time, right? I add a topic to this. I can even create a topic, or I can select anyone. See, these are the topics which are already created. So I can just select one topic which is relevant to this, and I can share it. For example, the relevant topic for this is setting instructional objectives in behavioral terms. So I'll just search for that, and I'll just click it. Setting instructional objectives in behavioral terms. This is the rubric part, which I'm going to explain later on. Now I give instructions as we give to all the students that answer within, say for example, answer within 100 words or whatever, or all questions are compulsory or whatever, you can write your instructions accordingly. This is getting auto-saved, see, right? So now I can assign. When I click on assign, my students get an instant notification on their mail. See, it appears on the classwork page that I have given post, I have posted an assignment, but of course it will appear under that relevant topic. Remember that, okay? So you have to scroll down on the classwork page and search that relevant topic under which you posted that assignment. Here, I have posted the assignment, it is given. The due date is also mentioned. And on the stream page also, the students get a notification that I have posted an assignment. Right. Now, this is how your student is going to receive. Now, let me just explain. What I have done is, for demonstration purpose, I have logged in with a different Gmail ID of mine. I have enrolled myself as a student in my Google Classroom. And I have received the assignment. Now, I'm going to play the role of the student. So this is from here onwards, you see what your students are going to do when they receive an assignment. This is the mail on which I have received the assignment from my teacher. So now I access it. This is how it will appear to your students, right? I open it. This is how your students are going to see your assignment. This is the assignment which they can open and they can have a look, right? They can add or create their answers from Google Drive, link, file, or docs, slides, sheets, and drawings, whatever they can use. Now I have just prepared an answer which I've saved on my PC. So I'm going to just upload and browse, which is saved on my desktop. I just select the relevant file, assignment, answer to assignment, and just open it. So it gets auto saved. It gets saved on my classroom page. Right. So what I do is I can add a private comment as a student to the teacher over here that I'm submitting my assignment. This private comments can be seen only by this individual student and by the teacher, right? Or I can even add a class comment, which all the entire class can see that over here also, right? For example, I'm just writing that I'm submitting my assignment. So I post these two comments, right? So now I have uploaded my answer. I have now I need to turn in. Turn in means to submit, okay? Turn in. When I click on turn in, it asks me whether I really want to turn it in or not. So I just click on turn in once again. That means as a student, I have submitted my assignment, okay? This is, now this is how I am receiving as a teacher. I am receiving this as a teacher on my email ID that my student has answered my assignment. So now onwards, you'll see what the teacher's role is. Okay. I go to my classroom, Google Classroom page. I click on classwork. I scroll down to the relevant topic under which I had posted my material, my assignment, I'm sorry. I click on this. It's written here that one person has turned in and six haven't. Six are yet assigned but not yet turned in. So only one has submitted. Turned in means one is submitted. So I just click on this and I can see this page. I click on the assignment. If I want to read what response my student has given, I click on this page. Now my student's response is appearing. This is what my student has written back. So as a teacher, what I can do is I can add comments and I can evaluate it online. I can highlight certain portions and I can comment on it. Simple. I just can click on these particular words and particular sentences and highlight them like that. And I can just write my comment. Just as you write in copies. For example, I'm writing correct. Okay. So here again, I select and highlight and I comment. I've written correct. So comment. I've given two comments. Now I give marks to my students. Since my student has answered correctly, I give 10 out of 10 to my students. I add a private comment. Very good. Right? So everything done. Now I just post my comment. My student will receive it through mail. And I just click on return. Return gives me two options. That is return this submission or multiple submissions. I click on this submission. So they're asking me whether I really want to return or not to one student. I click on return. So this is how I'm going to return the assignment to my students. So this is the entire process of, returning, creating material assignment, sharing with your students, how your students are going to take the materials, reply and prepare their assignment answers, and they're going to upload, and how you are going to again see their answers and mark them. Now, a very important part of Google Classroom, rubrics. Now, what are rubrics? Now, let me tell you something. It is very simple to assess students on the basis of quizzes, because quizzes have objective type questions, one mark, two marks, and autocorrect answers can be given up, and marking is far simple. But it's very difficult to assess students on the basis of assignments, which are written in paragraph style or, a long answer style. So there you can create certain parameters on the basis of which you will assess your students. So now what you do is you create those parameters, you can share it with your co-teachers so that if there is objectivity in their evaluation, and your rubrics are also visible to your students. When your students see the rubrics, they see that exactly what am I going to be marked on. These are the parameters, so I have to be cautious about these parameters. So the whole thing becomes very organized and very systematic. Now let's see how we're going to prepare the rubrics. Suppose this is the assignment that I'm giving to my students. Now I go to the assignment page, which I'm preparing. Right? See here, click on rubrics below. Create rubric. We can reuse or import rubric also, but I'm just creating one for you for demonstration purpose. So here you have to give the criteria. See, the question I had given is write the educational objectives. Right? So what I do is, the first criteria, for example, I write is learning objectives, which they have to write according to revised Bloom's taxonomy. So I give a criterion description. Criterion title is required, that is mandatory. Criterion description is where I describe what exactly this criterion is going to be. Like, all statements and action verbs must be correct, right? So now I allot marks or points to this. I mention the level. Like, if the student has fared in an excellent way, you give 5 marks, and what you see, this description is all correct. Similarly, I add 4 points, that is 4 marks. You give 4 marks, very good level. Description is if there is one error or one mistake. In this way, I can keep on adding levels, right? 3 marks you give for good performance, and maybe there are 2 mistakes. Right. Again, 2 marks, average performance. If there are 3 mistakes, average performance and 3 mistakes. Now, remember something that you, for anything, for example, if you are given paragraph writing or whatever, you can have different kind of criteria. For example, whether the student's spellings are correct or not, grammatical errors are there or not, sentence construction or vocabulary. You know, all these things can be your criteria. So the last level I'm adding over here is poor. That is if the student has made 4 mistakes. So just give 1 mark. This way you can just add one more criteria to this. You can add as many criteria. See, the next question I've given here is frame 5 questions and mention both the dimensions. So what I do is I give the next criteria as questions. First one was based on the objectives. The second one is based on the questions. So I just write questions must be properly constructed, right? Marks allotted. Each question must have the specific marks it is allotted, and it must mention the objectives. That is, both the dimensions of the objectives beside each question that should be mentioned. So objective dimensions mentioned. I add both objective dimensions, since according to revised Bloom's taxonomy, they have to mention both the objectives beside each question. Right. So this is the criterion description. So again, I just write the points. For example, 5 marks. For excellent performance, I give a description, all correct. All correct. 4 marks for very good performance, 1 error. 1 error. Like this, you can keep on adding the levels, and you can make them more specific, you know, so that whoever is assessing, your colleague can assess it on the basis of these rubrics. They will know exactly how to mark and assess your students. So this way you can just add the criteria, as many criteria as you want, and you can add the levels according to the requirement of your assignment. So I've just added the different levels. Okay, And now what I do is, now what I do is, now the points are added, see, 5 marks for each criteria. So I just save whatever rubric I have done. I just click on save. See, out of 10 marks, this is 5. So I just save. Now when I save, it brings me back to my assignment page. See, it shows rubrics 2 criteria, 10 points. That means I have saved by rubrics, and this is how your rubrics appear. Right? So this is a very, very helpful mode of creating the basic parameters of assessment. Now I move on to how you can delete a Google Classroom. Now remember something, you can have as many co-teachers in your class as you wish, but only the teacher who has created the class can delete the class. Now, for example, you are teaching one batch of students. Now, next year, that batch is going to be promoted to the next class. So this batch may not be relevant anymore. So you can either archive them. That is, they will not be there in the forefront, but they'll be saved and archived, from where you can import materials to your new class, and you can reuse the materials. Or you can, if you feel that this class is not required at all, you can delete the class. So this is the way you do it. Deleting the class. Suppose you just open the first interface. This is a demo class I created. So just click on the 3 dots and just click on archive. Just click on archive demo class. So now it's archived. Click on these 3 lines and just click on archive classes. Now you can only see archive classes, right? So again, you click on the 3 dots. It's giving me options like move, copy, restore, delete. So I just click on delete. Delete demo class, yes, delete. So now once and for all, this class is deleted. So this is how you can delete a Google class from your collection of classes. Now, last but not the least, I would like to share with you a very helpful Google Chrome extension. Now, these Chrome extensions are available from the Google Chrome browser, and they help to enrich your programs and make your tasks easier. So for that, what you do is this. I have selected this particularly because this is very helpful, an extension for your specifically for your Google Classroom. So for that, you have to just go to your Chrome browser. And you have to be logged into your Gmail ID and just go to Chrome Web Store. Okay, type Chrome Web Store. When you just type Chrome Web Store, right. So now you just type add to Google Classroom. There are several other of them, like share to Google Classroom is also there. I've just selected add to Google Classroom. You type it. So now it's going to show me this particular extension, add to Google Classroom. Now, since it's already downloaded to my system, it's written rated. Otherwise, you're going to see it as add to Chrome if it's not downloaded in your system. So you just click on add to Chrome and it will be downloaded and it will ask you to install it. Just install it and save it here. This is the extension icon, and all these extensions which I have saved are recorded here. So I just pin this add to Google Classroom extension whenever I require. I can unpin it when I don't require it. So it appears more prominently on this taskbar. And now let me show you how it's helpful. For example, if I am browsing the net and I am searching for certain materials to share with my class. So I just click on, for example, communication skills. I like this particular website and the materials given in this website, and I want to share it with my students in my Google Classroom. So now all I do is I just click on that Google Chrome extension that is add to Google Classroom. Whenever I click on that icon on top of there, I get the classroom icon. I click on that and they give me an option whether I want to share it as with which batch of students I want to share. So I just mention the batch. what action I want to do, whether I want to create an assignment or question or announcement. So I just click on create material because I want to give it to them as a material. Right? I click on go. So now they give me that create material page where I'm going to write down the topic, that is the title, communication. I write down the description. Right? It's added. Now the file is added. The students are there. I can give to particular students or to the entire class. Right? I select the semester I want to share with and I select the topic. Now, all I do is I simply post it. Now, it shows me you have posted to your class view. That means if I click on view, I'll be able to see that this material has been posted to my class. So this is just a shortcut. If you are browsing on your net and you get get to see a suitable material, you don't have to open your Google Classroom, add link and all that. Just download and install this Chrome extension. And you will be able to access it and you can directly contribute it to your Google Classroom. So that is all about my presentation. I hope I have not been able to cover all the topics, but I've tried to cover as much as I could. Last but not the least, I would like to say one thing, that please have a positive attitude and embrace technology, because technology today is extremely essential for all of us. And what is essential is we need to understand something, that I'm just stopping this sharing option. You need to understand something, that whenever you are using technology for your class, you're not only getting an enriching experience for yourself, you're also enriching the experience for your students. So I just stop sharing. Right. So you are if you are using technology for your class, you are always giving your students a better experience of different types of study materials. And these days, you know, students don't want to carry books and copies and papers and bags. They're just carrying materials in their pockets. So make things easier for them. Make things easier for us. And embrace technology. So that is all about my presentation. I don't know how far you could understand them, but I will upload them to my YouTube channel, and you can have a look at them once again if you want, because these are, I mean, if you see them once, they don't get into your head. You just have to follow them like hands-on, for hands-on training. So just go to the YouTube channel, which is with my name, and you can always access these materials from there. Once again, okay. So thank you, and over to the organizers. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, ma'am. I mean, it was so detailed and organized, meticulous. So it was a flawless kind of presentation, and it seemed as if we all were in the, you know, it was like a practical class based on
Absolutely. The business. It's for us also. So it's like a practical class.
So meticulous, and you had taken so much of pains. That was obvious that you had arranged everything part by part. I mean, so sequential, so logical. So brilliant kind of a presentation it was. Thank you so much, ma'am. Okay, as far as the questions are concerned, there was one question initially from Obhudoy Basu, but his question was, if I want to delete any particular class, how to do that? But I know that you have answered. Yes, you have already answered it during your presentation. And there is another question, which is, do you think that online mode of teaching has made the teaching learning procedure much more interactive and dynamic?
Well, of course, definitely yes. Because when you are seeing me face to face in the classroom, earlier what we used to do is we used to have digital boards. We were just coming closer, you know, using computers and having this digital classrooms, which were very expensive. But now what students are doing, the best part is, now remember something. Now education is being given for employability. And for employability, education has to be made accessible. So there are several, like nowadays, like we were getting educated for years and years where we were not even earning anything. And we were just ideologically, we were getting educated. But now we want a job as early as we can. So continuing education is most important. There are several times where we see in abroad, this is quite prevalent. While like we have long commuting times during jobs, if you have to go on the way, there are many students who take online classes on the way in between their jobs. So now with online classes, since you can give them an enriching experience with multimedia and with different kinds of sources, you have to remember one thing, that it's not just important that what you are serving, it's also important how you are serving it. You can just take a study material to your class and say, yes, you take this note and you photocopy it and return it back to me. And the other colleague of yours is saying, okay, fine, we've got this Google Classroom and I'm going to share these number of materials with you. And you're going to love the experience of seeing the YouTube. And just think, from a little kid to an adult, everybody will go for that because it's more attractive. Whether you are serving one sweet or whether you are serving rice, how you serve it is very important. So now you have to understand that education is now more interactive. It's not ideological, it's not secluded. So you have to embrace technology because now it's fast. Over the very recent past, technology has rapidly moved fast. I mean, rapidly it's advanced and progressed. So you have to understand that whenever you want to, like if you don't update yourself, you will remain backdated. People will move forward. So what's the big deal? As a teacher, you have to embrace technology. And it is not just for the teachers. See, many of our students run tutorials for learning, earning their pocket money. So they can have these Google Classrooms and they can share materials, whether it's COVID or not. It's always an enriching experience. So I think I have given an answer to the question that I was asked.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Okay, there is another question by Kamal Khemka. And his question is, what is the best in Google Classroom in comparison to other available platforms?
Well, frankly speaking, there are several other platforms, but you have the LMS platform, you can share materials on that, Moodle, everything is there. But Google Classroom, you know, what I feel is, what I find, Google, the steps that are to be used or whatever, that they're very simple. And Google is constantly updating things. Like there were options, like there was an online mode of class, which I'm not mentioning the name, where you could raise hands, right, to ask a question. But earlier on the Google Meet platform, you could not. But now they have added extensions where you can post emojis and you can raise a hand and you can, you know, kind of tell your teacher that you have a question to ask, or but if you like it, you can give a smile or whatever it is. So it's getting constantly upgraded. I think the simplest of the tools, simplest of the keys are with Google. So personally, I shouldn't make a generalized comment, but because I don't know that technology has advanced way too far throughout the world and we are still far lagging behind. But I find Google platform very convenient.
Okay, and it seems very user-friendly, right? Very, very user-friendly. Absolutely. So, okay, yes. Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. It has been such an enriching and engaging session. It was my pleasure and it was everybody's pleasure, I'm sure, to listen to you. Okay,
My regards to Principal Sir and the organizing team members and all my seniors and my colleagues. And all the participants for giving me a patient hearing. Thank you, ma'am.
It was a delight listening to you. Thank you, ma'am. All right. Thank you. Okay. So we would move on to the next session now. But as I said earlier, that we were expecting our Vice Chancellor, Sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bashok Chowdhury, to be here amongst us for the inaugural address. But since he has got some very, very important administrative work, so he could not be here today. So we are very sorry. We express our regret for that, but couldn't help it out. So in that case, we would move on to our next technical session. That is the second technical session for the day. And it's our proud privilege that we have amongst us, Dr. Amulya Kumar Acharya, who is Associate Professor and Head, Department of Education, Fakir Mohan University, Balasor, Orissa. He is with us and we would be listening to him very shortly. We are delighted, we are honored. It's our privilege to have you here, sir. And I would love to take this opportunity to say a few words about him. Dr. Amulya Kumar Acharya is currently working as an Associate Professor and Head, Postgraduate Department of Education, Fakir Mohan University, Balasore, Orissa. He has completed his Master's degree in Education from Sambalpur University, Orissa. He had done his PhD in Education from Utkal University, Orissa. He has got a teaching experience of 17 years in higher education. He has worked as Assistant Professor in Education at Panihari Mahavidyalaya, Sodhpur, Kolkata for 10 years under the Higher Education Department, Government of West Bengal. Prior to that, he had worked as principal at Ihayapur B.H. College under University of Burdwan. He had worked as lecturer at Jagannath Jain College, Jhumri Tilaya, a constituent college under Binoba Bhave University, Jharkhand. He has worked as assistant professor in B.Ed. at Ishan Institute of Management and Technology, Greater Noida, UP. He has also worked as assistant professor in B.Ed. at St. Vincent Paloti College, Raipur, Chhattisgarh. He has published 24 research articles in different national and international journals and has also published a good number of chapters in various edited books. He has authored 2 books so far. He has presented papers in various national and international seminars, workshops and conferences as both paper presenters and resource persons. Apart from that, he is good in handling administrative and academic responsibilities in his teaching career at different places successfully. His areas of interest include teacher education, guidance and counseling, educational psychology, trends and issues in education, and tribal studies. He is also a member of editorial boards of 2 journals and lifetime members of AIAER and IATE. It's our privilege, sir, that you are with us today. And Dr. Acharya would be talking on conventional to digital pedagogy, impact on mental health during pandemic. So that is his topic for today. Over to you, Dr. Acharya, conventional to digital pedagogy, impact on mental health during pandemic. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mahua madam. Nice to see you. I met you once. I think I was there to submit the answer scripts 2 years back. I think okay. You might be remembering me in the staff room. We met anyway.
So
thank
it's,
you.
It's really a small world, you see.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
And we happily collide with each other.
Yes. okay. Very good afternoon to all of you, to the organizing committee. At first, it's my privilege to be here, and my honor and gratitude to Honorable Principal Professor Talpatra and Honorable Vice Chancellor of West Bengal State University and Professor Abhijit Kumar Pal and all the organizing committee members of this Derijua College. The webinar organizing committee, our Debashisda and other Rina and my one more, sorry, at present I'm not remembering the name. Anyway, all the other faculty members. So thank you all for inviting me. I have chosen a topic. Actually, this is very common one, and madam has dealt with the digital aspects, the tools for digital pedagogy, and how we can be enriched through Google Classroom and Google Classrooms and various aspects of Google Classrooms. But I am going to deal with the conventional to digital pedagogy and impact on mental health during COVID-19. So you know that I think I had given the PPT to the organizing committee. Abhik Babu, please you can share from your side. Actually, as you know, that I'm not having very good network and I'm new to this platform. So I thought of to share with you and you can share during my presentation. Are you there? Please you can show it or I can start. before going to start, what is pedagogy? Because many of us we know that pedagogy, the word pedagogy is derived from the Greek two words, that is paedios and agogos, and is the study of how knowledge and skills are exchanged in an educational context. And the pedagogy, if we see the founder of pedagogy as an academic discipline, that Friedrich Herbert, a German philosopher and psychologist, is the considered as the founder of this pedagogy. And pedagogy is nothing, it's the art and science of how something is taught and the method behind the learning. And you can say skills and science and strategies for teaching to the children. And pedagogy includes how the teaching occurs, the approach to the teaching and learning, the way the content is delivered, and what the students learn as a result of a process. And next slide, please. And why pedagogy matters? Why we have chosen this pedagogy? As you know, a bird in a hand is better than 1,000 in the bushes. So you know that we were acquainted with the conventional classrooms, that we are very much comfortable with the conventional teaching. And due to the COVID-19 pandemic, since a couple of months we have shifted, there is a paradigm shift from digital to, from conventional to digital pedagogy. And why it matters? Professional development. Pedagogy is matter for professional development, cultivate the classroom culture for teaching and learning, choosing appropriate learning strategy, resource management, what they have, identify the problems and solving them. And what is conventional teaching strategy and conventional teaching method? All of you know that this is nothing. It's a face-to-face interaction. It's a chalk and talk method, and where the teacher is given due importance in the classroom, and teacher is the center of the classroom, and we dealt with it, the textbook, lecture notes, memorization, recitation, and it is teacher-directed technology, and traditional teaching, and back to basics we used to give. And where also critical thinking, problem solving, decision making, these were the also parameters of conventional teaching. And conventional teaching, discussion method, memorization, lecture method, students learn through listening and observation, and seat work was given importance in conventional teaching. And in online, next slide please. Online teaching, you know that conventional teaching, that was face to face. There was a fixed time, fixed place, direct, it was direct. There is a relation face-to-face between the student and teacher, teacher and taught, and the teacher-centered group activity was there, physical interaction, immediate feedback was there, peer cooperation was there, because there was collaboration, cooperative learning, and peer group discussions and all were there. Students were able to develop their interpersonal skills and develop manual skills, because we used to give some manual works, project and all. This was all about conventional teaching. And what about online teaching? How we have shifted to online teaching? Due to the COVID-19 pandemic, as the school closure and school colleges, everything closed, coaching center closed, and you know that there was no direct contact with the teacher and taught, and no library facilities was there. So we shifted to online teaching, and through internet. Mostly, internet is the basic and fundamental aspects of online teaching, and flexible time. There is also advantage of online teaching that we can fix up the class according to the students' timing, according to our own suitability, and we can also change and shift our classes to our convenient time. At any place we can have, just you see that all of we are at home and we are taking classes, we are conducting teaching learning process, and it's indirect. You know that there is no face-to-face with most of the students, they are passive, and this is indirect method of teaching. And child-centered to some extent, because the child, they can go through the study material, they can, what we are, as Madam said, Madam Dr. Sen said, that we are sending the text materials, we are sending the videos, we are sending them different interactive classes, and that they are going through at any time through YouTube and anything. And individual activity, the students, they can have individualized learning according to their own pace and according to their own rate. And the virtual interaction, the interaction is mostly virtually, that there is no face-to-face interaction. We cannot read the face, whether they are understanding or not, because many are not also responding, whether they could follow or not. Simply we are teaching and many are not listening simply. One or two students are just asking questions, rest are silent. So virtual interaction is there. So we do not see whether they are sleeping, whether they are working, or what they are doing. We are not interacting with them. And late feedback. The feedback is late generally, and in classroom, quick feedback we used to get, because we just say, while I'm teaching, you don't interrupt. At the end only, you can ask the questions. Generally, we do. But in the general classroom, conventional classroom, the students, they ask in between, they interrupt at in between to the teacher, and they get clarified, and we proceed, because the diagnostic questions we ask also, developmental questions also we ask in between, for knowing the progress and how far they have learned and how far they have understood the concept. And it is independent and create isolation. You know that there is isolation. The schools, colleges, you just see that we are here in our Odisha. Almost all the teachers are coming and non-teaching staffs are coming in the universities and colleges since the middle of May. And we are simply sitting and no students are there. We are feeling isolated. And we are teaching here only looking to the monitor, looking to our mobile, but no students are there in front. So sometimes it's also difficult to some teachers to teach and to give their maximum output. That is also due to the isolation, they feel isolation. And we have to also develop digital skill. As madam said, it's convenient, but so far as my knowledge is concerned, I'm going to deal this subject in this topic in different way. And if you go through the statistics, if you go through the research studies, and the almost 40% students are not digitally accessible in higher education, and in primary, high school and higher secondary, almost 70% students are not accessible to this digital pedagogy. So, however, we had to shift to digital pedagogy, and why we shifted. Next slide, please. Due to shutdown of schools. As school, colleges, everything shut down in the mid of March, and there was for a couple of days there was no teaching learning, and in whole March month we could not decided whether the schools will be opening or not, and that was there was a gap in teaching learning process, and it catered the needs of all stages of education from pre-primary to university level. I have seen many pre-primary schools, preschools also, they are organizing classes, they are conducting classes through digital pedagogy, and that is also very convenient how they are rhymes and other alphabets, that there are so many videos, so many recordings are there, so many YouTube classes are there for pre-primary, and also that many private agencies that they have also developed the audio visual aids for teaching the pre-primary. And university level, you know that we are more matured because we have so many channels, we have so many agencies, they are providing e-learning facilities, and we are going through that. I will be discussing later on. And to engage the students, we can give tasks. As madam said, we can also supply them different materials for homework, and we can give different tasks for homework, they can study. And for evaluation also we can do that. Madam, I think she has taught that aspect also. I will be also just touching how we can evaluate. For transaction of curriculum, we are almost 50% of the syllabus we have covered so far from the July to September, and we are transacting the curriculum through digital pedagogy, through e-learning, and rapid development of technology due to the, because you know that today the school children, they are very comfortable with the mobile, with the internet, and they are watching TV, and they are more advanced, and they are digital friendly. So that is due to rapid development of technology that can be shifted in some extent. And paradigm shift in learning, you know that constructivism, the student can construct their ideas, they can create their own knowledge by using this digital pedagogy, and role of teacher shifted from stage on the stage to guide on the side. And we are just guiding. We have little to do, and many things they are also doing. They are studying, but in the same time also that we are not competent. Our teachers are not competent enough to deal with digital pedagogy like us, those who are conventional teacher. And it's quite difficult to develop a study material, and also we are not comfortable to create study material in all languages. So many criteria are there, and we don't have that facility also in our institutions or at our home places. So many problems are there. And innovative teaching activities can be done, that you know, the gaming simulation discussion can be done through digital pedagogy. And digital pedagogy refers to the use of, next slide. Digital pedagogy refers to the use of technology in teaching and learning, and digital pedagogy includes several changes to traditional pedagogy. And you know that use of technology, that we are it is not only discusses the use of technology, but also approaches digital tools from a critical pedagogical perspective. And emerging from distance learning, digital pedagogy has brought numerous changes in the field of education. As you know that earlier, in our for academic purposes, we were using for distance learning. It was mostly used for IGNO students, for Netaji Subhash Open University or any other universities. They were using this digital pedagogy, and also NCRT. They were having the classes through this different. They have their channels, DD32 and all that. Now they are frequently creating videos and audios for the students, but earlier also they were delivering the talk, delivering the lessons through digital pedagogy, and they were also making videos and audios for the students. And digital pedagogy goes beyond that to include teaching about and for digital technology for learning. It is going beyond the classroom teaching, and you know there are three areas of knowledge of digital pedagogy. Next slide. Areas of knowledge of a digital pedagogy. One is a content aspect, another is a technology aspect, and third one is pedagogy aspect. What is content aspect? Content aspect is the subject matter that is to be taught. Many teachers they feel uncomfortable to speak before the video or the through the digital gadgets, because they do not have enough or rich content knowledge. So in order to teach through the digital pedagogy, you need to have rich content areas and knowledge, and you must be very conversant with the content areas and content knowledge. And technology, that is another aspect which includes latest technology such as computer, internet, mobiles, digital video, e-books, open educational resources, and technologies including overhead projector, blackboards, and books. And these things also that we have to convert, and we are not technology friendly. Many of us, we need to be very conversant, and we need to be very comfortable, and we need to be trained in technology for proper digital pedagogy. And pedagogy is another aspect. Simply you have content knowledge, simply you have technology, that will not suffice your purpose. That will not your purpose. You should know how to transact. What are the methods and strategies to transact that pedagogy? That is the important thing. That you need to develop some strategies, procedure, methods of teaching and learning, which is very important aspects of teaching. And you know that technology cannot replace pedagogy. So technology is only an aid. It is a supplement. It is a supplement for teaching, but you cannot say that technology cannot fulfill the purpose of teaching and learning in 21st century. A country like India, in Asian countries, and many countries are underdeveloped countries. Still, we have problem. Still, we have so many barriers, and there are. This is particularly vulnerable among the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, and rural population, and the students, those who are coming from low socioeconomic status. They don't have a mobile in their hand, and also they don't have a good network, and so many problems. Even if for studying also, many people, they have only single room. They don't have enough rooms to study and listen silently. Their parents are there, their younger brothers, sisters are there. So even if they are at home, they are not listening properly. I have experience. Many of my students, while they are listening, while they are asking questions, someone is disturbing, mother is talking, father is talking, or the neighbor is talking, someone is shouting, and so many disturbances are there. And you know that many of us do not have enough rooms or separate study room. That is the problem for which that I will discuss with regard to mental health, how mental health problem we are having due to this technology. Then pedagogical shift from traditional to digital, because consumption to creation, correct to correcting, content to conversation, and control to chaos. This is another aspect. We are pedagogical shift from traditional to digital, and these are the advantages we are having. And you know that various skills and competencies to develop on the part of students and teachers for using digital pedagogy. Next slide, please. Surfing the internet and locating useful information from the internet. I'm telling you, just day before yesterday also, I was taking the doubt clearing classes for this forthcoming examination for my students. As we have not provided much study material, we only we have given lectures and some PDF we have given, and many teachers have not also provided the study materials. So even if we are telling you follow, you just go through the internet and search, and they are unable to identify which one will be the correct and best one for answering. How much I supposed to take? So these are the things they are having problem. Though they are having a guard gates, but still then we need to help them how to use it properly, how to, even if how to search, they don't know how. They ask, generally one student asks, sir, what I should write for this answer? Where I will get the philosophical basis of values? Where I will get? What I will write in URL, then how will get? So these are the things they are asking. So even if ours, we the teachers, sometimes we face the problem, and you know that many articles that is not accessible for everyone, and that is a problem that we are facing, same also they are facing. So surfing the internet, that skill also the students and the teachers, both they should have. And also many of us, we do not have the institutional ID for searching and for surfing. That is also another problem that also we should have, everyone supposed to get. And generating printing documents like students assignment, newsletter, communication, these are the also problem. You just see assignment we collected, some students they have sent, there are 10, say for an example, 5 papers, and there are 2 assignments in each paper, and they have sent. And some students they could send easily, and some students they could not send. They said, sir, I'm not sending, it's not uploading properly, and there are so many pages, and it is not going easily, and some pages are going, some pages are missing. So these are the problem they are facing. And also you know that we have to generate documents, we have to maximize their efficiency, how to use, how to apply, how to develop the application and other efficiency with regard to this digital pedagogy. Using technology to gather, organize, and report information about student performance, like Excel, access for database management. Even if many of our students, they do not know, even if your teachers also, we are not that much comfortable to do work in Excel, and to even if in a project work, in a dissertation, they faced lots of problems as they were there. And we used to advise something, we used to suggest something, we used to tell them something, and they used to understand something other. So these are the problem in approach to approach. And even if some students, after completion of the class, they are telling, sir, what you have taught, I could not listen at all due to the connectivity problem. So this was the output. At the end, the students is telling like this. So in that way, I do generally, once again, I just summarize for 5 minutes. So you see, these are the problems, and you know that different developing tools to evaluate technology-based student projects, like word processing, multimedia, database, spreadsheet, PowerPoint, desktop publishing, and internet and telecommunication. Sir, one more example I am giving. Many are telling, yeah, we have to shift to the digital pedagogy. So anyway, we are going to have our practical examination for dissertation on 30th and 29th. So how will send 50 students are there in MED, BEd and MED integrated, and 35 students are there in MA education. How will send all the dissertation to the examiner? What we did, we just asked the students to prepare only one page abstract, and that will send beforehand, and without reading and going through the dissertation, he will ask one or two questions. So these are the problems we have. So we cannot, and we are not that much efficient. So we should not compare what we have, we should not look others also, we should not infer others, and there is an individual difference that we have to keep in our mind, that no two individuals are alike. And in a country like India, and a state like Odisha, and state like Bihar, state like Madhya Pradesh, state like Chhattisgarh, many parts are inaccessible, and there is no internet facilities much, that means good connectivity. And also, you know that every day that there is rain, there is a flood, and so many natural calamities are there. It's a thundering. So in that time, how the students will appear examination, if that is the exam, and how they will send. And you know that also, while sending in Google form, many are telling, yes, everything is possible. I just faced the problem. We asked for choosing the CBCS courses for the students. Out of one day we gave, from morning 10 to night 10, it was open, the Google form, only out of 32 students, and 30 students could submit successfully, 2 students they could not submit. This is the case of master degree students of second year. What about the undergraduate students? What about the higher secondary students? What about the lower secondary students and upper primary or primary set students? So these are the technical problem. These are the technical issues of digital pedagogy, which causes poor mental health and stress and other things that I'm going to discuss. And just a research output. Next slide, please. I'm not dealing all this. Next, please. Yeah. One research output, what? Students are generally less satisfied with courses that have been converted online. This is a study in 2018. Also, there are so many studies in 2000. This is a research article that is the findings. This is the research findings that students are less satisfied, even if you compare the achievement level. Even if you compare the scholastic achievement, that also they are not doing, and they are copying. Simply, I am telling my son what he did during the examination. He called his math teacher. He was a little poor in math. And he called, I was not there. And his mother also didn't tell me regarding this. He called his math teacher, sir, please, can you come today? Because I have got exam. If there is any problem, you will help me there. So this is the case. And another thing I'm telling you, one day what happened, that on the day of science examination, he could not submit the Google form properly. And what, he was stressed. And I was taking class. I was supposed to deliver a lecture for Sambalpur University. I was there, and both my wife and son, they repeatedly telephoned, and I was disturbed whether I will take class or I will listen them. Whether I will take class or listen them. You just see, he is acquainted with the computer from class 1, studying in a CBSE school, and he failed to register it properly. And it could not submit by successfully. This was the problem. Then my wife telephoned to his school teacher and subject teacher. They said, you write only the answer in the pen and you send me in my WhatsApp. Then problem was solved, and out of 40, he got 38. So he was full of stress, and he scolded her mother. He fought with the mother. So, and because he complained about the mobile, about the network, you change this mobile, because the younger one is playing with that mobile and with YouTube and all. That is why there is some problem, technological error, so he could not submit it well. So this is the, and during this mental health in COVID situation, this is my point. As we shifted from conventional to digital pedagogy, we hardly get an opportunity to speak, to interact with our friends, and to interact with the teachers, to have a chowmin or egg roll or whatever it is in a cafeteria. We used to spend a good time over there. And that most of the time we were spending at school at least 6 to 7 hours, including the bus travel. In 8 hours, we were, this child was spending. So while he is staying at home and he is engaged 3 to 4 classes, and I have observed there is adverse effect. My son is fighting every day, and what he is doing? He is having no other work, and he is demanding her mother, you would prepare this food, you prepare this item, this is not good one, that is not good one, and he is telling and he is complaining so many things. He is complaining so many things. Yeah, some questions are there. I will later on I shall discuss. This mental health during this COVID situation, as we shifted from digital pedagogy or e-learning, whatever it is, that effect of pedagogical shift on mental health, how depression is there, loneliness and isolation is there, lack of interest in activities, because as you know that they were engaged in other creative activities, in games and sports classroom, music class, and other things, and they used to face problem at home because everything is closed. And anxiety, more anxiety, when the school will reopen, when exam will be held, what will be the process of and modalities of examination, and lack of motivation in studies, because you know that they are inside the four walls of a classroom, and they are not well motivated. They, because there is a competition and cooperation while they are going to schools, but at home there is no competition. They are hardly discussing with their peer groups. They are not going through who is studying what, how they are doing, whether their friends are answering properly in the classroom. If the friend answer well, then the other one generally becomes jealous and becomes eager to becomes more sincere and serious to learn. So changes in sleep or eating patterns, you know. And that is another one. As most of the time we are using our screen, we are using the guard gates, definitely it there will be no sound sleeping. There is will be a difficulty in sleeping. And concentration also, that when we look at the screen, most of the time there will be concentration problem and changes, lack of sociability is there also, that we are not able to interact with our friends, interact with our neighbors and relatives, our family outside the family members, our teachers. So there is also lack of sociability and lack of motivation is there. Worsening of chronic health problem. In my son case, I'm telling that he is facing, as he is arthritis patient, and he's having the problem, joint pains and all. As you know, that he is not getting scope for outing and other. Most of the time he is sitting and studying, watching TVs. So spending the time in this way. So definitely he is gaining the weight, and there is no muscular activities as such. So mental health condition is also worsening. He is having so many problems. That health issues and all, and increased use of tobaccos, alcohol and other substances. So you know that the strategic city has been increased since a couple of months. Then what to do? This sleep well and eat well, that we have to go for sound sleeping, get right information. You know that through internet, what we are getting through social media, what's of and even information, wrong information. We have to be in touch of government, our state government and central government, WHO and other agencies, those who are giving right and correct information that we need to have. And develop different hobbies like singing, drawing and creative abilities, activities and all we have to engage during this pandemic. And another thing, schedule and follow a routine, because as we are at home, we are spending most of the time at home without any schedule, without any proper routine work, and simply we are wasting time. Even if our productivity, what we used to work, that we are not able to work that much, as there was a college or school that time where if students are there, then we are more interested, we are more that means energized to teach rather than simply sitting at home. That is not fulfilling our purpose. Engage in family activities, simplify information to children, take time to relax. Sometimes also we supposed to give them valuable information. We have to teach them what are the things they need to learn from the internet, from the different sites. And we have to be very careful also. We have to be very careful while the students, they are using the mobiles or electronic gadgets. We have to be very careful and we have to take precautions what they are doing. And we have to be very vigilant at that time. And socialize using phone calls and social media. That also we can do. And false tips general, do not, what we should not do. False information and rumors, it increase anxiety. That also a mental health problem occurs. Risk taking behaviors, while we are going out, we have to take precautions. We have to abide by the guidelines of government, and refusing to follow rules, that also many are doing, that we should not do. Social isolation leads to boredom and loneliness. That also creates a mental health problem. And alcohol and drugs, that is also faulty coping we are doing. Next slide. That this is a slide of our ministry of health and family welfare. I have collected this one. And anxiety, how you will identify the anxiety and psychological issues and with the students. Anxiety associated with the COVID-19 pandemic may lead to psychological issues. Sudden changes in school performance and poor grades, if the due to the as students were acquainted, well acquainted with the conventional teaching, as there is sudden changes in school procedure, their teaching strategy and teaching methodology and modalities of instruction. And also you can find that if the students is not coping with that one, that technology or e-learning, that sudden changes in school performance and poor grades, that also may be the psychological issues, that may be the anxiety. Delayed physical or mental development, if that the student is not mentally sound and he is not using his abilities, potentialities in right way, that in a delayed physical development, that also can be due to the psychological stress and anxiety. Poor attention and hyperactivity, that also may be the reason. And frequent changes in emotions and mood, that is also another reason of psychological issues. And frequent temper and aggression, that also may be the reason of psychological issues. And recent sleep disturbances, as I discussed, that sleep disturbances is there, that many students, as they are simply at home and in daytime they are all sleeping. Many, even if a small child, children, they are telling that they are sleeping at night 1 and 12:30, 1:30, like that, because there is no good routine and healthy routine they are maintaining during the pandemic due to some or other factor. Next slide. Anxiety associated with the COVID-19 pandemic may lead to psychological issues. What? Connect with your family and friends. How we can, if in case you are feeling anxious and stressed out, that you, how you can overcome, that connect with your family and friends over the telephone, over the video calling, and you share your experiences, how you are spending time, how you are utilizing your time properly, leisure time. exercise and meditate regularly. That we have to give more priorities with exercise, as many doctors also advising and health experts they are advising during this COVID pandemic. We should go for regular exercise inside the room. We can have indoor exercise or on roof of our building, that we can do. And also nearby, that means where there is less populated places and there is no much rush, there we can also have exercise and we can utilize our time properly. Sleep adequately, at least as much as the doctor advised, and there are so many guidelines, I'm not going to deal those parts. And eat a balanced diet. This is very important, because vulnerability to those who have diseases, those who are malnutrition, that we may face problem during this pandemic, and mental health problem may occur due to the poor diet. That is also we have to be very careful and think positive. That we have to think positive during this pandemic, because we don't have any other resources. We are not going outside, and we are most of the employees, they are working from home, and also children, they are not going to school, they are studying at home. So we have to think positive most of the time. We have to see that this pandemic is for a time being, and we are going to overcome very soon. These things we have to keep in our mind, and we have to teach our students that this is not going to linger, and we are going to overcome very soon. And another next slide. If at all require, we can contact the NIMHANS. You know, that is the best one. They are working for the mental health and how to overcome the poor mental health and different crisis and issues related to mental health. We can call them and we can ask, we can follow their literature, their materials, and we can overcome the mental health issues. And also, do not let myths flourish and facts be buried. Many things what we do, that the myths are flourished generally and facts are buried generally. That we have to be very careful. And during this pandemic, we have to give right information, and wrong information should not be spread and should not be discussed much. And we have to develop positive attitude. And another thing is there of a Minister of Health and Family Welfare, Badalkar apna vyavahar karenge corona par bhar. So we have to change our attitude, change our behavior, change our lifestyle. And also, now accustomed with the change of the teaching learning process, modalities of teaching learning process, we have to adapt. We have to develop positive attitude towards the e-learning and pedagogy, digital pedagogy. And next, last slide, I think it's, we have to maintain a safe distance, and we can remain safer. And at least that 2 gauges, that 6 feet advised by the government of India, that we have Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, that we have to do and maintain distance from others. Many are telling that we are using mask, we are maintaining distance, but still we are not going to school, we are not going to colleges, but still we are getting the disease, and we are committing the coronavirus. So whatever may be the reason, that we don't know, but anyway, we have to be very, very careful. And as you know, that we are going to the schools and colleges are going to open, and there are some policies, the central government, even if our state governments, they are giving 25% of the study materials that will be in blended approach, because we have already spent 3 months, July, August, September, 3 months is we are going to waste, and we are dealing, and some colleges and schools still they have not started their online teaching, or they are going to start. So we are really delayed, and we are going to have our regular mode of teaching very soon. But however, we have to adopt e-learning, or we have to be efficient, we have to be conversant, we have to be trained in digital pedagogy to overcome the difficulties, because time is coming and government is also this new national education policy 2020 also, that they are telling for equitable and inclusive education, pedagogy, that digital learning or e-learning should be given a more importance, and there will be social agenda. There is a that you know that Shikshak Parv is going on for inclusion and equity, but you know in many things we preach but we never practice, but whatever the provision may be, that still there is inequality. It may be with regard to teaching learning, may be digital or conventional, but we are not giving the opportunity to access this digital pedagogy or e-learning or online learning, whatever you defined, whatever may be the terminology. So gender inclusion fund, that is, introduced by the Government of India, Ministry of Education, gender inclusion fund for we have a gender gap with related to education, that we are going to that disparity we are going to reduce, and there is a fund government is going to provide. And special education zones, those who are vulnerable, those who are inaccessible, living in inaccessible areas, those who are not having any facilities, so they, for them, and special children also, that special, now you know inclusive education has come, most women, rural population and minorities, everyone is under the inclusive, and socially economically disadvantaged section of the society, all are including. And mentoring, that is going to be very serious steps of the Ministry of Education for mentoring for equitable and inclusive education, and counseling for socio-emotional and academic advancement. That is very important, because counseling, that we are least concerned with the counseling in colleges and schools, that counseling is integral part of education. Even if during the pandemic, I hope few of us, we generally counsel our students for solving their problems, for giving assistance for their own adjustment in their own pace and learning at their own pace and own rate. And financial assistance also will be given for equitable and inclusive education, and scholarship, that is also going to be increased in coming years to minimize the gap, and equitable and inclusive education, and for enriching the socially economically disadvantaged group of the people. And this is all about my concept. However, you may say that we are more advanced. You don't compare Kolkata and you don't compare your students with the other part of the country. That I am living in a particular, my university is in a city, and most of the students, 70% to 80% students, they are from village, 80% students. And they are facing lots of problem. I can say you 70% to 80% students, they are getting good connectivity. Still 30% students, they are not getting. And out of that, you can say that many are not having a system. Many are not having, that means I think 10% students, they have a laptop, 90% or desktop, 90% students, they don't have. So while we are asking to prepare during this pandemic, while we are asking to prepare this dissertation, project work, assignment, and other things, how they will do? We can preach many things. Yes, this can be done, this can be done, but this is for the sake of teacher. But you have to think the other part. That is the more important, how the problem can be solved, how the problem can be eradicated, how we can maximize the teaching learning process through e-learning or digital learning. That we have to educate ourselves, and we have to also train our students for for be technologically friendly, for easy access to the technology. And who will support? We are telling that yes, they can do. Who will provide them a system? Who will provide them? There is a one single phone. Many children, if you compare to the students, I can say you that many students, they don't have phones in school. The parents, they have, they are going to market, they are going to for their business, they are going for their job, and only one phone is there. So what will do? What the son will do during that time? How he will learn? So who will fill the gap? Who will fill the gap? These disparities, these inequalities. This is digital inequalities, digital inaccessibilities. That we have to be very careful. Which causes poor mental health, stress, that shyness, isolation, and abnormal behavior, and other aspects, other behavioral problem and behavioral issues, because they feel inferiority complex. The other friend, he is having a phone, he is accessing good Android phone, and the one is not having. And that quality, very poor quality, that it's not visible, this not clear, it's not audible, and somewhat it is broken. And also the network is poor. So many issues are there. We have so we teaching and this digital or online teaching, whatever you say, we have to go side by side, and we have to fill the gap in some extent, but we cannot fulfill the purpose. The purpose cannot be fulfilled in e-learning or how much we preach. So this is just like in a AC room we are planning, just like our planners they do. But in reality, we have to go beyond to the classroom, beyond our environment where we are living, and we have to see them whether it's possible or not. So how we will fill that gap, that is a problem. How they will cover those syllabus when they will come to the schools, and how those who are not getting not accessible, not getting connectivity, or not getting having facilities. And I can say 80% students, and in schools in my states, I am telling you, 95% primary students, they have not got the benefits of e-learning and online learning. 70% of students of high schools, they have not got the benefits of e-learning and online learning. Higher secondary, more than 60% students or 50% students, they have not got the advantage of e-learning and online learning during. And in colleges, more than 40% students, they could not get the advantage, or they could not get the scope to have a good connectivity or to get the maximum utilization of this e-learning. So it is easy to say, but it is difficult to do, difficult to practice. That is my point. That is why that you can observe your children, even if your this will create this pandemic. This is a great loss. Many students are going to drop out as they are not having, their parents are not having a job, or they are not in touch with the studies. And you will see that many will not get information to appear the examination, particularly at a graduation level. Many, you can find, many won't get the facility, many won't get the information to appear the examination as we are going to conduct very soon. That I am telling you, that which will cause the mental problem, which will cause the mental health problem. And that we need to give priorities, all the educationists, all the stakeholders, all the administrators of the educational institutions, to rethink, reconceptualize, and we have to ponder about the matter. We have to think about the matter, how to overcome this crisis, how to overcome this problem, that e-learning or conventional learning or digital learning, that there is a confusion, which one is the best. We can't say that this is the best, and still we need the conventional learning. I am telling, even if that you take a class in a face-to-face mode, and you compare, you take a class in conventional learning, you conduct the research, I am telling you, the performance, the achievement will be poor in conventional learning, digital learning or e-learning, rather than conventional learning. I can tell you that you conduct, that this is my own views, but I have not conducted. I think many will conduct, or many have been conducted, that the scholastic achievement in conventional learning, but that is not fair. If they are doing well, that is not fairly they have secured. They have malpractice. I can say from my own child, that he is tampering, he is malpracticing. He is managing to secure good marks, but sometimes he fails. He is having the books here. Even if our students, they will do. They will look and write. This is just like open book examination art. Many countries they are doing. This is practice doing. That we are not that much. Our socio-economic condition we have to see. Their family condition we have to see. That we good study habit is required for self-study. They won't study. As they are coming to school, they are coming to college, they are studying. At home, nobody is going to study. Simply, many are just connecting for the attendance. I came to know from my student, from the leader, from the class representative. Sir, many students are simply, they are connecting and they are cooking. They are going market and they are leaving phone there. You inquire also. You call your friend, your student. He won't receive your phone during the teaching, while you are teaching. He will be doing something else. Someone is going by bicycle, marketing, this and that, and they are having connection. How they will hear you properly? How you can ensure that your students are listening you properly? You are not going to see, and they are not going on them, showing you their face, or their most of them are unmute. Sorry, so this is the problem we are facing. So this is all about my approach, all about my views with regard to digital pedagogy. We have to be, it will take time. It may be a supplement. It may be an advantage over the conventional teaching, but we cannot replace it as we are doing at present. This can go side by side. We can blended it. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for thank you to the organizing committee, and if you had all any questions, over to Madam Mohua. Okay,
thank you very much. I mean, you raised such pertinent questions and such practical problems you dealt with. Really, these are problems particularly for our kind of country, the developing nations. So there, this kind of technical glitches and the students not having enough data, or you know, these are the problems which are faced by all our students, and we all are acquainted with those kind of problems. But you ended at a very positive note, where you talked about, you know, the various ways, the various measures that can be adopted, and the do's and the don'ts which can help us get attuned to a kind of a healthy living. So thank you very much. It was a very organized and very pertinent kind of lecture, very informative and useful. Thank you, Dr. Acharya. Now we have got questions here. One question is again from Kamal Khemka. Yeah, there was one question for Dr. Shane also from him. Okay, Kamal is asking, what will be the effect of national education policy on competitive exams?
Yeah. National education policy, you know that they are going to make it a transparent and a digitalized mode. And you know that all the NEET, it is very going on very nicely. Though there is some issues, but state like Odisha, that nobody is absent as such. Many are appearing, almost attendance is 90% in the NEET examination. Again, I am also observer of NEET examination, that medical for UG examination on Saturday and Sunday. It's going very nicely. Even if NEET and other types of competitive exams, this is going to be one of the most in digitalized mode. That is why I told that we need training. That many of us, they are not conversant to appear the examination in online mode. That we need to practice also. We supposed to transfer in our educational system, in our colleges. We need to conduct also the internal examination through online. Who will develop the schedule? Who will develop? So many things are there. How there are many teachers, they cannot make a Google form. They cannot make the questions in other modalities also besides Google form. Also, it's difficult to check the answers. Many are not conversant. So that will take time, but government is going to do it in very systematic way and very digital manner. And corruption will be less in this procedure. So far my knowledge is concerned, because you cannot manipulate the questions. As there is a complaint we used to had, as I was in Bengal, my students, they said, sir, my friend, she didn't fill in the OMR seat, but she got, it was blank in the OMR seat in primary teacher for TET, but she got the job. So how it is possible? So there is a question, there is a doubt for tampering, there is a misusing and malpracticing, but this one may not be possible, and this will we are going to overcome all those problems. And also this will minimize the expenditure, and it would be less, that means we can reach the students easily and monitor the students easily, and also we can evaluate the questions answer very within small time. So this is you can say welcoming steps by NEP, what they are going to have, and that is one single board, that NTA, that National Testing Agency. Most of the examination they are going to conduct under that one, all competitive examination.
All right, thank you, sir. There is another question from Dr. Shunanda Haldar, who is our colleague from the Department of Chemistry. She has asked, what is your opinion regarding e-examination procedure, what we are to practice in near future? What is your opinion regarding e-examination procedure?
You see, e-examination we can have inside the campus in that means a direct, not indirect. As they are sitting at home and they are appearing examination, you cannot check all the shortcomings what we have in this system. So e-examination can be conducted very nicely, but if you are conducting in your lab, and if there are some procedure, you know that I came to know some private universities, they conducted, and you cannot move from your camera. Once you move from the camera, then again you have to log in, that you will be log out. There are so many modalities. I can tell you, the technology specialist, the software specialist, they can advise, but this procedure, what the West Bengal or the Odisha we are going to conduct, or other parts of the country we are going to conduct, that is just for the sake of examination we are conducting, for the sake of UGC guideline, for obeying the UGC guideline and Ministry of Education guideline we are conducting, but we are not going to fulfill the purpose, the real purpose of examination, that will be hidden, that will we are going to lack, and we are going to mismatch between the achievement and the knowledge. That knowledge and achievement, what we have acquired, what is the outcome? Outcome based, that cannot be. This is not the proper outcome based. That learning outcome cannot be achieved properly through this process, through this strategy which we are going to. But in future, this online, if he, that it will take time, we need to be trained. We need to be comfortable, and we need to be enriched in online for as you know that the various modalities are there. We need to be trained, and government of India as well as our state government, they should conduct some orientation classes, refresher, and hands-on experience, as Madam Sen said. We need hands-on experience, and then only we can be a mentor for conducting the online examination. This can be in future, it will, but in a country like India, it's not totally we cannot do, but say for an example, IITs, NITs, all universities, postgraduate examination, and some competitive examination we can do. But for primary, secondary, higher secondary, even if colleges, in West Bengal, if you see, only 50 colleges are there, only in cities, or 100 colleges, I think 100. Heart of the city, you can find 100 colleges. Not what about the other colleges? What about the other students? So during the pandemic, even if in city, the Murshidabad student, the Bankuda, Purulia, Kochbihar student, he is studying at Kolkata, but at present he is in his interior village. So how he will appear? There is no connectivity, there is no facility. So these are the issues we have. We cannot overcome, we cannot solve over the night. It will take, I think, not less than 2030. We may be mature enough to conduct, but this is not the right time to switch over to the online examination.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. Now we have got a question from the organizing secretary himself, Debashish Chatterjee. Yeah. He is asking that what is the difference between the virtual mode of class that we are taking now and the virtual mode of distance learning?
Yeah. Virtual modes of distance learning is already there from a couple of years. You know that after opening up this IGNO, Indira Gandhi National Open University, that was the first institution, and through DEC, Distance Education Council, that is they started program, and they have their own studio, they have their own channels, and that they are doing it successfully. And there are some other parts also that Bhoj Open University they started also, but Netaji is not that much good there. Even if our Odisha Open University, they are not that much good, they are not doing that much well, this virtual one. Even if they are conducting classes simply for distance mode, they are conducting face-to-face class, but many countries they have shifted the offline campus and online, that in campus and off campus. In campus students they are coming and they are having the face-to-face mode, as well as the videos are recorded, interactive classes are recorded, and that is given to the, they have their own ID. Every students have got an ID. If someone is missing the class, he can get through his ID what the teacher taught in the class. That both the modes are there. But there are students, those who never attend the classes, simply they get all sorts of materials, all sorts of teaching through virtually, and that is purely distance mode. And in distance mode of admission, distance mode of intake, we are using virtual, that is a part of teaching learning material, but the distance learning and virtual learning, these are different. Distance learning can be given virtually, can be given text, can be given, that we are also giving them study material, that is given also. But that virtual is started in distance mode in the beginning, and later on we are doing, and some universities, some IITs, NITs, IIMs, they have started also. And during this pandemic, we are forced to switch over the virtual or e-learning. But that is already there. This virtual mode is already there, but we are not accustomed with that, and we are not practicing in our regular courses. And now we are doing, and we are going to do also in future, because government is planning that we have to give in both the modes.
Okay, thank you. There is another question. I presume this will be the last question for the session, because already, yes, okay. So the last question is again from Debashish Chatterjee himself, that you talked about the concept of digital pedagogy. So is it called e-pedagogy? So is the digital pedagogy the e-pedagogy?
Yeah, digital, electronic and digital. Digital means that is E is electronic is the broader concept, and digital is the narrow concept. E, electronic, all this, but everything is not digital. Digital, that we can say, this is only the terminology we are using for digital purpose, because this is not conventional that we are using that particular term. If you say what is digital, that I think that definition we have to go through the encyclopedia, but the we are changing the term interchangeably, e-learning and digital pedagogy. But pedagogy is the science and techniques of teaching using for the digital purpose, that is called digital pedagogy. And also in the same case, e-learning is the part of digital pedagogy, and e-learning is the broader aspect, digital pedagogy is the part of e-learning. E-learning, that means even if we are in a Facebook Live, that is also, we are giving teaching, that is also e-learning. And also WhatsApp, what we are giving them material, that is also e-learning. Everything, whatever the electronic gadgets is used, that is e-learning. That we are, this is a process, that is a digital mechanism is followed, that is why this is a digital. But if you, I'm telling you, if you go through the dictionary, that encyclopedia, then you can get the what is the concept of a digital pedagogy. But a digital pedagogy I have used for the purpose of e-learning, that pedagogy earlier conventional, now we have shifted to e-learning or digital pedagogy. So this is the basic, I have to use the term interchangeably, but not the correct word I can say that what I have used. So this is for the sake of you can say for goodness, for giving a right title I have used. But digital, you know that without transaction, you are sending money face to face by someone, but we are giving by transacting online transaction. That is also digital. Government is initiating to do all the work in digital. So we are giving their, our PAN card and other things. Earlier what we were doing, we are giving manual. Now also you can upload yourself you can make a scan and you can upload your own KYC. So this is digital. There is less paperwork. That in that sense, I have used this is digital, where there is less paperwork and less contact between the teacher and taught.
Okay. Thank you so much. I sincerely hope that all the participants have gained in lots of information, and both the sessions have been very interactive and insightful. So thank you to both the speakers. As far as the feedback link is concerned, you will be getting that tomorrow after this, because it's a two-day webinar. So you'll be getting it after tomorrow's session. So it is time for the vote of thanks. Before moving on with that, I would like to request all of you to subscribe to our YouTube channel, the college YouTube channel that we have, where this kind of academic programs are uploaded time to time. So we sincerely hope that you would be subscribing to it. Now it's time for the vote of thanks. May I request Dr. Shoikot Mondol, Associate Professor, Department of Bengali, and Joint Convener, Seminar Program Committee, DeRozio Memorial College, to deliver the vote of thanks. Over to you, Shoikot.
Thank you, Mohadi. Good evening, all of you. Now the time is vote of thanks session. So at first, I am thankful to the eminent resource person, Dr. Shorindri Sen, Assistant Professor, Gopal Chandra Memorial College of Education, and Dr. Amulya Kumar Acharya, Associate Professor and Head Department of Education, Fakir Mohan University, Balasur, Odisha, whose lecture enriched this webinar. I would like to say that in the present scenario, this discussion is significant when we all are taking online classes during the COVID-19 pandemic time. And rightly he says that easy to say, difficult to do. And then I thanks to organizing secretary and all faculty member of Department of Education for organizing this informative webinar. And then I thanks to Sri Tapus Chatterjee, President Governing Body of our college, and Deputy Mayor Bidhan Nagar Municipal Corporation for his encouragement. I am grateful to Dr. Dibendu Talapathy, Principal of our college, for all his support. Mention must be made of Dr. Choitali Mukherjee, Coordinator ICAC, for her valuable suggestion and for financial support from ICAC. Dr. Anjana Chattopadhyay, TCS and convener, and TCS and Joint Convener Seminar Program Committee, has worked hard for this webinar. So thank you. I must thank Dr. Ovik Roy, librarian of our college, who is the technical coordinator of this webinar. I am also grateful to Anirban Bosu Rai Choudhury, Department of Journalism and Mass Communication, for the CREATE concept. Also thank you Dr. Moha Bhoumik, Department of Education, head of the Department of English of our college. I would also thank the non-teaching staff of the college for their support. The student union must be thanked for their cooperation. Finally, a big thank you to all the participants without whom this webinar would not have been possible. So thank you again. Thank you, all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shoikot, for delivering the vote of thanks. I must thank you for, you know, taking this effort. And so see you all tomorrow. Tomorrow is day two and the final day for this international webinar. So I sincerely hope that the kind of enthusiasm, the kind of active cooperation and participation we have received today, you are not going to fail us tomorrow. And tomorrow also, it will be an equally interactive and interesting session. So see you all tomorrow. Stay tuned and stay safe. Good evening, and okay, see you. Bye-bye.